Hi guys, welcome back to another Real Talk series, and I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit more about my journey towards conscious consumerism. As you guys know, last year I decided that after watching Kimberly Clark talk about anti-haul and realizing that I'm spending so much of my money, even money that I don't have yet in my bank account, towards purchasing makeup that I don't really use often. I mean, I've got only one face, two eyes, one nose, two cheeks, one set of lips, you know, a set of eyebrows, that's it. So having so much and having duplicates of the same things was like sort of an awakening for me when I watched Kimberly Clark, and I started watching a few more people do their anti-hauls, talk about consumerism and why it's not healthy for you, and also realizing that a lot of the stuff that we throw away because we don't actually use them end up in landfills, end up in the ocean being eaten by the same seafood that we ingest ourselves, and we are poisoning ourselves, and it's a vicious cycle. So anyway, this morning as I was going through my YouTube feed, I saw this series called Make Up My Mind by Lucia Tepper Beauty. And so I watched it and I just sort of like realized and kind of inspired me to make this video again, and to talk a little bit more about my own journey and how I've weaned myself from buying so much makeup. In fact, not only have I lost my VIB status at Sephora, I've also managed to whittle down my collection to more than half. Like, I've sold or given away or thrown out products that I don't use. The ones that were thrown out are usually expired because I've had them in my collection and never really got around to using them and stuff like that. Those that were given away went to friends of mine who like share the same skin tone or had, because I've got a few makeup artist friends back home in the Philippines, and every time I would visit, I would bring some of my stuff, as well as to like cousins and friends who share the same makeup passion as I do. So anyways, there's a Facebook page here in Australia where I could sell my pre-loved but really, really good condition makeup. And I've had a few, like, and that to me was actually really good, because then I didn't end up losing all the money that I spent on those makeup, but actually getting some back, which is what I recommend you do if you have something like that where you're from. Okay. Now, and another thing that sparked my interest to talk about this was a series of declutter videos that Rachel Jade, a near here in Australia, has done this past week. And she had like 500 lipsticks and 300 foundations or blushes or something like that. And I was like, holy shit, man. When do you get... And I am by no means a collector of makeups. I used to. I used to really like, especially the MAC limited edition collections. I used to really like them. I had to have my my hands on them. But you know what? Afterwards, I realized, look, if I don't use this limited edition products, I would have effectively just thrown out money, because those things aren't cheap. They're actually a little bit more expensive than their permanent line because they're limited edition, harder to get hold of, and also quite hyped up most of the time. So I'm like, wait, if I don't use it, then I'm effectively just throwing out money. So I started using my limited edition ones. And once they're gone, I'm going to bring them back to MAC and get a lipstick for them, because why not? Okay. So there were a few points that I listed down that I wanted to talk about, and what I think about them in terms of the general beauty community on YouTube, and why I feel like all of these beauty gurus or self-proclaimed beauty gurus who keep pushing products to us and keep telling us to buy stuff because they're obsessed, they're shooked, it's a holy grail, you gotta get it, you gotta get your hands on it, you are living under a rock if you don't know about this product, and if you don't have it, why don't you have it, kind of thing. I'm like, the hell, right? So I just wanted to talk a little bit more about it. Like, when I watch this beauty gurus do their PR unboxing, and they do like sort of a, what do you call this, first impression kind of thing on the products that they get, and I'm like, really? You're gonna tell your millions of viewers to buy a product that you received for free, by the way. I have nothing against companies giving products to influencers. That's absolutely fine. That's how the marketing world works. And sending them products to YouTube beauty gurus is probably so much cheaper than getting a celebrity to endorse a brand. So that's what it essentially, it's a marketing ploy. It's a marketing ploy for us to watch these relatable influencers who are the same people as us go through products, recommend their products, and say you need it in your life, right? So for me, this PR unboxing is a little bit deceiving because obviously they didn't pay for it with their own money. And I find that a lot of beauty gurus are hesitant or reluctant to say negative things about products even if they fail them, or try to hide it in a really nice manner so that they don't offend the brands, because obviously if the brands get offended, they don't get sent products, or they don't get sponsorship, they don't get paid to talk about the products anymore. And realistically speaking, that's their job. How do beauty gurus use that as a full-time job? They get paid to talk about products, and that's, some of them will tell you that upfront, and some of them will just tell you, oh, this got sent to me, without telling you that they were actually paid to talk about the product. Some of them actually just get sent it, and they it's up to them to decide whether they want to talk about it or not. But obviously, if they want to get to be on the good side of these major brands, they're going to talk about it, and they're going to talk nice things about it, and probably not tell the consumers that it's not the best product out there and you can definitely get something for cheaper, or you probably don't even need it in your life, right? So I find that PR unboxing, especially all those massive PR unboxings, that tells you just how much influence these people have and how much brands are trying to woo them to represent them in their YouTube videos, sending them to the Maldives or to the Bahamas or to Cabo or wherever, like taking them on beach excursions, putting them up in this 5-star luxury resorts and stuff like that. Obviously, when you are somebody receiving that kind of perk, you wouldn't want that to stop, right? And if you don't want it to stop, you better be saying the right things, regardless of how that will affect your viewers as consumers, right? Because at the end of the day, it's a dog-eat-dog out there, and dog-eat-dog world out there, and they are going to do whatever it takes for them to be able to survive. It is what it is, okay? Another thing that sort of like irks me is when people call their videos reviews when in fact they are first impressions. They haven't even tested the product for at least a week. Some of them have only like tested it on camera, not even like testing it out for an entire day to see how it wears. You could put on eyeshadow and have it fall out on your face or crease within an hour or two of putting them on. And if you're going to apply it on camera and say, oh, this one's nice, it's got, like, it swatches so well and it blends so easily, but what happens at the end of the day? Is it still there? Right? It's sort of misleading. I mean, call it a first impression if it's a first impression. Don't call it a review and mislead your consumers or your viewers into thinking that that's a really great palette, especially if that palette is like $50 or up. Come on. Now, even actually like affordable palettes, let's say Wet n Wild or Essence or like your drugstore products, if you buy multiples under the same brand, that still adds up. And especially here in Australia, like how much is a chocolate bar palette? $45 in the US? That's $70 here in Australia. That's not cheap. Okay. Hourglass blushes are like what, $32? $36? I'm not sure. Here in Australia it's $56, I think. $55 or $56. That's not cheap. And for you to say that a product is excellent and great condition, and I'm so shook. What does that even mean? Right? Oh, that it's your holy grail after you've only tried it once on camera is bullshit. I'm just gonna call it what it is. It's bullshit. Okay? Like, you're so in love, you're so obsessed. And I was watching Lucia and she was saying, do you even know what the word obsessed means? It means that you keep on doing it over and over again and you can't stop yourself from doing it because you're obsessed, right? It's all you can think about. It's all you can do. If you're obsessed with something and then next month you have another favorite, that's kind of odd to me. Like these monthly favorites things, and this ties into to this as well. Like every month they would come out with their monthly favorite, their favorite. And then at the end of the year, they would tell you what their yearly favorite was. And you'll find that it keeps on changing. Like every month they, I suppose because they get a lot of products sent to them every month, they have a new favorite and they're gonna encourage you to buy that favorite. But then next month, 30 days later, they have something else to talk about and you haven't even had the chance to actually go out and buy the product that they recommended last month, let alone what they're gonna recommend now, right? And I'm like, if something is your favorite, do you really forget about it after a month already? Is it that quick? Do you change your boyfriends that quickly as well? I don't know. Because me, if I have a favorite, like I've got a favorite t-shirt that I have had for like 7 years. 7 years is what it takes. Whatever happened to all of this, I remember YouTube was all over the Makeup Geek makeup. They were all over MAC at some point. I remember when I started watching YouTube, MAC was everybody's favorite. It was like the blank type and all that glitters and like all of these satin taupe, right? Everybody was talking about this. Inglot was like the next best thing. It was like it had almost twice as much product for less price than MAC, and everybody was talking about it. But nobody seems to be talking about that now, because so many brands have come out, like beauty gurus themselves have come out with their own brands, their own line of makeup, which I've no issues with. That's fine. That's you enterprising. That's you being a business person, okay? But if you were telling me that this was the best ones, and I'm sure that they've tried so many other things because they keep getting sent stuff, then fine. But I just feel like everything is just a mad rush to go out and buy stuff that you probably already have in your collection. To have 500 lipsticks, and I'm betting like 50% of that is the same shade, right? It just does not make sense. It's a whole lot of wasted money. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay. So I'm like, whatever happened to the old favorites? I mean, after I've decluttered my stash, after I've given out half of my makeup and all that stuff, I am left with my MAC products, I am left with my Inglot products, I am left with my NARS, like classic favorites, because that's what works for me. Not just because something is new and all it's been hyped up by YouTube gurus doesn't mean that you have to have it in your life, or it doesn't mean that it's going to be the right one for you. Choose what's right for you. Okay, and I think the whole mess that this is especially the younger generation, they have this fear of missing out on things, or what they call FOMO, right? They have fear of missing out. And if your influencer, YouTuber keeps telling you that you need it in your life, that they are obsessed with, that it's their holy grail, right? That you need to go out and get it right now. Pause this video and go out and get it right now, right? I've heard some beauty groups say that. You have to be accountable for the recommendations that you make, okay? But every time you push that product and you say to them, you need to go out and buy it, you need to pause this video and go get it now, that you are shook, you are obsessed, that this is the love of your life and it's your holy grail, you are not giving them that opportunity to think for themselves, because they are hooked on your opinion of something and you're practically telling them that they are missing out if they're not gonna get it. So yeah, I just really wanted to talk a little bit about that, because I feel like beauty influencers on YouTube, like especially the ones with massive following, have lost accountability towards their viewers. They don't care anymore how that affects their viewers. They just want to sell, because that's the marketing side of it, and that's how they get paid by brands. Like, that's what an influencer is. You influence them to do stuff that they normally would not do. Okay? So that's why I have unsubscribed to so many of this beauty gurus. I have also stopped watching haul videos, because you know what? I have everything that I need in my collection, and it's gonna last me like 3 or 4 lifetimes, so I don't really need to be told what else is out there. So that's my thoughts on that. How do you feel about beauty influencers trying to push products on you and telling you that it shook them and they are obsessed and it's their holy grail, and then next month they have a new holy grail? Okay, let me know in the comment section down below if this video made any sense to you guys. I appreciate it. Subscribe if you haven't already. See you in the next one.